Pastor Porter said, go on preaching. So pray that the Lord has a word. Y'all gonna help me today?
Yeah.
I got one help in the house. I call her Mohawk. And all she hollers, push it, Pitts. Push it, Pitts. And so nobody else say nothing. I just want you to know we're gonna turn her loose. Mark, the 14th chapter. I'm going to read a couple of verses starting at verse number 3. When you have to say amen. While he was in Bethany reclining at the table in the home of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster box, a very expensive perfume, made of pure nard. She broke the box and poured the perfume on his head. Some of these present were saying in an indignant way to one another, why this waste of perfume? It could have been sold for more than a year's wages and the money given to the poor. And they rebuked her harshly. Leave her alone, said Jesus. Why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you will always have with you, and you can help them anytime you want. But you will not always have me. She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare for my burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will always be told in memory of her. That's enough for today. Simple title for today's message. And God, we thank you again for this precious gift, and we look forward to you speaking. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Have you done all you can do? Have you done all you can do? The year was 1856. A slave from Richmond, Virginia, named Henry Brown, decided he didn't want to be a slave anymore. Henry Brown found a small box and postmarked it to Philadelphia, which was a free territory. Sealed from the inside, he mailed himself, banking on the U.S. Postal Service to deliver him to Philadelphia. This slave needed to believe beyond where he was in order to experience what might be. Mr. Brown took a big risk, low oxygen, no food. He took a big risk, hungry. He took a big risk and somehow dying in the box. But he wanted to be free so bad, he postmarked himself from inside the box. Well, we thank God for the testimony and the witness of Brother Brown, because he demonstrates to us that when something is on the inside of you, it has to come out. Regardless of what people might think about it, regardless of what they might say about it, regardless of what they may criticize you for, if something is on the inside, it can't hold you back. It has got to come out. I think that's where we are in today's text as we peruse this simple pericope, and we find out that there's a woman that we find that shows up somewhere in between a plot to kill Jesus and Judas trying to betray him. And so somehow Mark wants to squeeze this woman's story to help us understand that always in the midst of a plot and a plan, there's always good news. In the midst of somebody scheming and plotting against what God is trying to do in your life, there's always good news. In the midst of what somebody is trying to do to you instead of doing for you, there's always good news. There was some folks plotting in order to kill Jesus, and there was Judas trying to hand him over, but yet we find that there's a woman in between sounds getting ready to tell us what it's like to be a Christian. I like that, because every now and again there needs to be somebody that just won't talk about Christianity, but that will live Christianity. There is always a difference between orthodoxy and orthopraxy. Orthodoxy, we're always talking about what it means to be Christ-like. Orthopraxy says it's time to get up off our butt and do what the Lord has led us to do. Sandwiched in between this plot and this plan, there's this woman that shows up. where Jesus was, the Bible says that he somehow is Simon the leper's house. Sometimes says that's past tense, a leper, but I like to think he is still a leper, could be possibly, but Jesus in his house. It's not unlike Jesus to be with the outcast and the undesirables, but he's inside the house, reclining, waiting to be served, probably talking about what it means to be who you are in God. And suddenly, out of nowhere, without a knock on a door, an unnamed woman anonymously shows up, breaks a bottle of perfume over his head and pours the oil on his head. Now this is a Holocaust to me in the sense where she shows up unnamed, she shows up without an invitation, she shows up in the men's crowd, shows up uninvited, unplanned, unanticipated, and does something that somehow gets everybody's attention. She somehow shows up uninvited, but she had to get something off of her chest. Can you see it in the text somehow or another? It was something on the inside that no matter what was going on the outside, it had to come out. There was something that was done to her that she had to share with somebody else in order that they may experience what was done to this text. Excites me when we find that this woman sandwiched in between a plan and a plot. She shows up at a leper's house where Jesus is reclining. She breaks a bottle and pours it over his head. Offensive, she didn't even ask the owner if she could come in. She didn't ask the owner if she wanted help, who was going to clean up. She didn't even ask the owner if it was all right to be there. But yet, when you got something on the inside of you, you're not concerned about the question. Leper house looking to acknowledge Jesus. When she got there, she breaks over an expensive bottle, an alabaster box, and she anoints, or she pours oil on his head. And everybody is wondering, what's that smell in the house? What's going on in the house? Why is she in the house doing what she's doing? What, this Simon, did you invite her here? Isn't this just for us? Isn't this our club? Isn't this our time? Isn't she not supposed to be here? What is she doing in the room? Women are supposed to mingle with men in this day. What is she doing in the house? Somebody get her up out of here. But yet, she didn't care what they were going to say. She showed up anyway. That's a lesson for some of us, that when God puts something on the inside of you, you want to not be concerned about what people are going to say outside of you. Concerned about what people say. Too many of us are concerned about what they're going to say. Too many of us are concerned about what they're going to do. And we're actually held back from fulfilling God's will, all because we're worried about what somebody is going to say. But yet, see, Jesus is on his Lenten period that every now and again, you got to have some spontaneous praise. You got to have some spontaneous action. You got to be led by the Spirit, that's not controlled by any tradition, by what folks might say, by any limitations, by what about it. Doesn't make a difference how old you are, how young you are, how long you've been in the church. If you got God on the inside, he's still talking. He's still moving. He's still saying something. We want to not be so nice and dainty with our service to God, but you got to make some noise every now and again. The woman shows up at the house, unexpected and unplanned, disrupts the conversation and dinner. You know there's a problem in the house now. Breaks open the bottle, don't know who gonna clean up the mess. Fills the room with the scent of expensive perfume. I like that. I like that because we need some Christians that got that kind of boldness in their life. And if this is time for you to dial back and think about where you are in terms of your relationship with God, hopefully you'll get some boldness back in your life. Does it make any sense for Moses to go tell Pharaoh to let God's people go? Does it make any sense for Noah to try to build a boat in the desert that had never rained before? Does it make any sense to walk around the walls and think they gonna come tumbling down? Does it make any sense to not bow, go in the fiery furnace and think God gonna shake it? Does it make any sense, Daniel at the age of 80-something to go in the lion's den? You done served your time. You done did your time. But God needs some bold soldiers in order to fulfill God's plan. And so, I just want to tell somebody during this time if you're dialing back to reflect upon what it is to be a Christian as you move towards celebrating the resurrection. You want to get some boldness back. You want to get your courage back. You want to get your strength back. You want to get your swagger back. You want to get your power back. You want to get your love back. You want to get your peace back. You want to get your joy back. You want to get back to where you are. Stop turning tail and being lame and speak out and let everybody know I've been touched by God. I don't know if she's a sinner. It doesn't say. I'm not sure where she came from. It doesn't say. I'm not sure who her relatives are. It doesn't say. Just a woman that shows up unannounced, anonymously, and she does something in order to honor Jesus Christ. That means all of us are candidates to do exactly what she did. It doesn't about who you're attached to, who your lineage is. It doesn't mean how many sins you had, what you did or didn't do. You have the power and the right to celebrate God when He shows up. That's what the text is telling the teacher. Mark wants to share with us that it doesn't make a difference if this woman sinned or not. It doesn't say that. It doesn't make a difference who she's attached to, where she came from. It doesn't say what she did, where she was from. It just says a woman. Implying He wants you to insert your name in that. Wherever you find some anonymous conversation going on, some unknown, unnamed character, you want to put your name right there. You want to make sure your name right there. Or Pastor Porter shows up and brings off that expensive perfume and drops it down in order to honor God. You want to put your name right there. Deacon Henson shows up with all that money he stored up and gives to the church. You want to put your name right there. Deacon David shows up with what he had been storing away and gave it to the church. You want to put your name right there. It means that all of us have ample opportunity in order to show God that He's worthy. And the challenge as we dial back in order to press forward and celebrate the resurrection is to find some boldness again.
My Lord.
In order to exemplify that we have come in contact with the Lord somewhere. You ain't got to tell them where it was at, but somewhere. You ain't got to tell them because you won't show them, but somewhere. They ain't got to know, but somewhere. They ain't got to know where, but somewhere. They ain't got to know how, but somewhere. They ain't got to know the time, but somewhere. Somewhere you came in contact with the Lord and you're here to give Him worship. I read a story, Reverend Porter read a story about a man that just walked into church one day. He didn't smell too good, so they was wondering where he came from. But I thought the marquee said church on the outside.
All right.
He showed up and everybody was concerned about how he smelled. And he was just hollering, "Thank you, Jesus!" Like he had Tourette's or something. "Thank you, Jesus!" Out of nowhere. "Thank you, Jesus!" Not sure. "Thank you, Jesus!" And so somebody said, "He's making too much noise. We're having service. Thank you, Jesus!" It just came up out of him. "Thank you, Jesus!" So they called the guards to come usher him out. And they had to carry him from the middle of the pew all the way out. And he's still hollering, "Thank you, Jesus!" Because he was on the inside and it had to come out. "Thank you, Jesus!" He got to the door and in between this "Thank you, Jesus," he told the deacon that was ushering him out, because you know you can get some deacons to usher some folks out. To one of the deacons, "I'm giving him thanks because I ain't got no place to stay, but I always got a roof over my head. Thank you, Jesus. I ain't got no job, but I still eat every day. Thank you, Jesus. I ain't got no place, no friends, but I thought I'd come here and meet somebody. Thank you, Jesus." You never know why somebody got a "Thank you, Jesus" on the inside, but every now and again, you ought to have a "Thank you, Jesus" on the inside. Don't worry about why. Don't worry about what's going on. Just believe God is always doing something in order to
decided to show up and thank Jesus for what she had. But she showed up and gave him thanks. Because he was there. For no other reason, just because he was there. There in the second movement, I find in the text, in order to make sure you embody what it means to give birth to real Christian walk, you ought to not concern yourself with your critics.
All right.
It's right there in the text. As you look at the text, what you'll find is that most of us have issues with doing something because we're worried about what somebody's going to say.
All right.
And notice we're not worried about what they're saying outside. We're worried about what somebody's going to say on the inside. Look at the text. It was those on the inside. After all, it was Passover time. You had thousands of folks showing up here in Jerusalem in order to celebrate the Passover. Well, we don't know where she come from. They said about 85,000 to 300,000 folks that showed up in order to celebrate what God had done for the Israelites when they...